All right, welcome to FixedByDoc. I'm stabilizing the camera real quick. So today I wanted to define what off-grid or living off-grid means to me. And first and foremost, it means being completely, totally, 100% self-reliant. There are a lot of people out there who define being off-grid in their own words, in their own definition. And there's gonna be probably 99.9% of the population is probably going to disagree with me about what off-grid means, and that's fine. They can define it any way they want. This is how I define being off-grid. And first and foremost, being off-grid means totally self-reliant. It means being able to provide, produce, and supply everything you need for yourself, your family, your pets, your livestock, and if need be, your friends and neighbors on a short-term basis. And let's see, that means being able to provide all your own food, and be or if you can't provide 100% of your own food, be able to provide something that you can trade for your own food. So to my left here, he has livestock, he has beef cattle, and to the left of him, they have milk cattle. And to the right of me, he has grows corn and stuff like that and whatnot. And not only does the guy to the left of me grow beef cattle and stuff like that, he also owns the property in front of me that grows hay and everything else. So if I needed feed for my, when I eventually have livestock, he grows all the food for livestock. So if I needed feed for my livestock, I could exchange something I have for livestock feed and we could trade. So that's being off-grid and self-reliant. If I can't produce it myself, I can produce something to trade for it, to barter or trade. So being off-grid means that if the grid were to go down, it wouldn't affect you in any way, shape, or form. Being off-grid means self-reliant, to be able to produce and supply everything that you need for yourself and your family, or being able to produce stuff that you can trade to get for yourself and your family. Not only being able to produce stuff or being able to trade for stuff, but being off-grid means being able to make connections with other people who can produce and trade for stuff. So I could have one of the biggest self-producing products that I have on my property is blackberries. Okay, so I'm just gonna use those for an example. I can make the best, for an example, hypothetical, I can make the best blackberry jam in the world. But if I have nobody to trade it with, it's worthless. So one of the key things to being off-grid is having connections and people who want what you produce and who have what you need and are willing to trade for it. So being off-grid to me is being able to be self-sustaining and making connections and self-reliant, all that kind of stuff. So another step in being off-grid and part of that self-reliance thing is being able to produce your own power, water, and food. So I have 2.5 acres. Turning around here, I'm sure you can see it through the trees back there. I have 2.5 acres of farm field. I call it farm field because it's always been a cornfield or hay field or whatever. It gets plowed every year and they grow something on it. But I now have 2.5 acres of that, and I will continue to grow something on it. And what I intend to do to maintain my off-grid sustainability is I'm gonna plant, bordering my 2.5 acres out there, I'm planting fruit trees. So I'll have a fruit orchard out there, all different kinds of apples and peaches and pears and all kinds of stuff. Any kind of fruit trees that I can plant out there that will grow. Plus I plan and intend to plant a big garden, at least a quarter acre garden, because with just my wife and I don't think we need much more than a quarter acre of garden out there. And then we'll have, we intend to get goats and chickens and rabbits as well. So we will grow however big of a garden that we need to feed them too. So that's part of our food. We have wild grapes, wild blackberries, and all kinds of other wild fruit growing all over the property too. So that we are self-reliant because we have the ability to grow all the food we need. We are, as far as protein, we will have the chickens and the rabbits for protein. We can hunt. Just today I saw a deer run right through there, right through our woods, ran over there and disappeared off into the woods over there. I didn't go chase it down, but we had a deer run right through the property. And we have wild rabbit and deer, and there's even been a bear spotted, not by us, we didn't see it, but the person we're buying the property from had chased a bear out of here just before he sold us the property. So we've had bear spotted, we've had lots of deer, rabbit, squirrel, groundhog, and all that kind of stuff. So there's our protein for we can hunt. And of course birds, turkeys, geese, ducks, all that stuff flies over too. So even though we have creeks, we don't have any fish. But we can, we are making a pond, so if we make our pond large enough and we stock it, we could have fish if we wanted to. Although I don't like fish, but my wife does eat it. And I'm sure the neighbors eat it too, so we could grow fish for trade and make those connections. So food is more than taken care of. Then we have fuel. With fuel, our primary fuel source is wind, sun, and wood. For cooking and heating, we're using wood because wood is, we live in a forest. We're calling our property the Everfree Forest. We have wood stoves. We use wood for our heating our water with a thermal siphon system, which you'll eventually, once we get it set up, you'll see that. We are also heating the cabin with wood, and we are cooking on wood. So we have a wood stove that will go inside the cabin. We have a wood stove that goes outside the cabin. And we have a third wood stove that is portable and can be taken and moved around wherever we want. The third wood stove I actually made and have a 4 or 5 videos up of me making it, if you want to check that out. And it actually works extremely well. So. But the other two I didn't make, and I have, you'll get to see those eventually. Actually, I have four wood stoves. So, and I don't know what we'll do with the fourth one. I guess we'll probably use it as a backup. But the gnats are out today like mad. So for our primary wood for heating and cooking and hot water will be wood. And wood is renewable. It's definitely an off-grid fuel source, and it's a permanent off-grid fuel source because we can grow it. And when we take down a tree, we can plant two in its place. And we have 7.5 acres of wood wilderness or forest. We have 2.5 acres of field. So with just the two of us in our small little cabin, we should have no trouble whatsoever keeping a good supply of wood and whatnot to keep us in good shape. So our neighbors also have huge chunks of forest land and stuff like that, so if we had to, we could always barter with them for wood. And we've already discussed that with them as well, with the person we're buying this property from. And if we needed to, we have that ability. We are working a deal with the Forestry Service to get 250 trees a year for free. They're about, you know, baby trees, about 1.5 feet, 2 feet tall, that we could plant in of any variety. The current owner that we're buying the property from, he gets a form that every year from the Forestry Service that he could fill out, and he picks and chooses whatever trees he wants, and then they deliver it to him, and all he does is plant them on his property. Absolutely 100% free. So he's gonna hook us up with that. and shows how to get involved with that. So as we chop down trees for wood, we get free trees to replace them. It doesn't cost us a cent. So it's completely renewable. Let's see, wind. We have a wind turbine. Now, the wind turbine itself, I do not consider it to be off-grid because it will break down. It's only off-grid for 15 years. After 15 years, it needs to be serviced. And if there is no grid, then you can't get it serviced. You can't replace the parts in it or anything like that. It'd be hard. It would be, I can't say you can't, but it would be really hard to do if in the event that the system went down, if the government collapsed, whatever, and didn't come back. In 15 years, the wind turbine would shut down and we wouldn't be able to use it anymore without replacing the bearings and all that kind of stuff. And I don't have the knowledge to rebuild it, not the one that we own. I could build another one, but the one I own, I wouldn't be able to rebuild it because there's nothing to take apart and refix. It's all compartmentalized and internal. So, but while it's working for that 15-year period and it's maintenance-free during that 15-year period, because it lasts so long, you could call it off-grid for that 15 years. Wind, however, is a renewable and somewhat reliable source, especially out there in my field. I could build there's a difference between a windmill and a wind turbine. A wind turbine produces electricity. A windmill produces a function. The function of a windmill is generally to either pump water or mill grain into flour and stuff like that, or to move things or winch things or whatever. And I could very easily take the wood that I've got, build a windmill, and use that to turn my grain that I grow in my field into flour and feed my, you know, make bread or whatever and do all kinds of stuff. I can pump the water out of my creek into my storage tanks and all kinds of stuff like that. So when the wind turbine stops functioning, I could turn it into, you know, I could take the propellers and stuff off of it and turn it into a windmill. And still use it in that sense. So that's off-grid because it's renewable, it's reliable. My water source is, let's go to the solar real quick. My solar panels only last, I think it said 25 years is the lifespan of my solar panels. So after 25 years, I can no longer produce electricity from my solar panels, or at least not usable electricity. But I can still use the sun. Sunlight is renewable. It's up half the day, at least a good 10 hours of the day I have sunlight. And I can use that sunlight using Fresnel lenses and other techniques to make solar ovens, solar heaters, dehydrators, and all kinds of stuff, like solar cookers, everything. So with a little knowledge and know-how, I can take that and use it to do all my needs. So there's only four things that you can consider to be off-grid fuel sources, and that's because they are renewable. And the last thing is water. If you have a creek or a river or a stream or a spring that has that you can get enough water pressure out of, you can use that water pressure to spin water wheels to either generate electricity or to generate a mill or to run a pump or something like that. If you can create enough water pressure, then you can use that water pressure as a tool to do other things. And personally, I have three motors, electric motors, that I will be turning into water turbines that my spring and my creek will be generating, will be used to generate electricity to trickle charge some battery banks. And the batteries that they'll be trickle charging will be running the water pumps to pump the water into my water tanks that are up there and into my storage tanks for my cabin. So as long as the water flows out of my springs, I've got electricity there. So the four sources that I consider off-grid fuel is wind, solar, water, and wood. Nothing else is an off-grid fuel source by my definition. Propane and gasoline, kerosene, diesel, those are not off-grid fuels because they you have to be stored, and when your storage runs out, that's it, you're done for. Your generator, your gas stove, your propane generators, your gasoline generators, your diesel generators, they're all gonna run out of fuel. You can only store a certain amount of fuel for so long. And when that fuel runs out, you're done for. It's it. It's, you can't do anything with it after a certain point. It's so what I call that, what I call those kind of fuels are boondocking fuels. You bring it in with you, you use it up, and then when it's gone, you have to leave. So boondocking is you bring everything in with you, you take it all out with you. Off-grid is you don't bring anything with you. You just, you come in, you build what you need from the land, and you live off the land as much as possible. And then what you need that the land can't provide, you take what the land does provide and trade for what it is that you need. You could take what you get off the land and trade it for some more gas, but if crap hits the fan, there's not gonna be any gas, there's not gonna be any propane, there's not gonna be any diesel. You know, that stuff's all gonna either be extremely expensive, under heavy guard, or stolen. Or you're gonna get yourself killed trying to go to the gas station and steal it or whatever, because everybody in the world, I know Evic Zebulanius keeps talking about how all the stores around him sell propane. Every store down the street, all around him, all the gas stations, all the hardware stores, everybody around him sells propane. And he stocks up a really good supply of propane. But he's not worried about running out, because if shit hits the fan, he could just go to the local store, cut the chain, and steal some propane if he needed to. Well, I guarantee you, your neighbor's thinking the same thing, the guy down the street's thinking that, and millions of people all around the country are thinking the exact same thing you are. So good luck with that. With me, I'm using wood, water, sun, and wind. I don't have to go anywhere. I can produce all of that right here on my own property. That's what off-grid is, producing everything you need right here where you're standing. So propane and gas, diesel, and all that kind of stuff, that is not an off-grid fuel source. That is a boondocking fuel source. When it's gone, it's gone. Don't expect to be able to go somewhere and refuel it. So let's see, there's another topic. For water, being off-grid, you have to be able to provide your own water. You can't be connected to the city and get your own water. That's not off-grid. So for us, our off-grid water source is our spring right over here. But we don't just have that one source. We also have another spring on the other side of the property. So if this spring, something were to happen to it, we have a second spring that's just as good as this one. And if something were to happen to that spring, we have a creek that runs behind us, that runs in between us and the field. And it's not as clean as the two springs, but we do have a really nice filter system that we can filter that out if we had to. And what's really nice about filter systems is we can make our own filter systems. We have the knowledge to. So knowledge is the biggest part about being off-grid. You have to have the knowledge to do things. You can't go off-grid without first and foremost having the knowledge of how to do things off-grid. If you live in a city and think you could just pack up your backpack and head out in the woods and go off-grid, you got another thing coming to you. You can't do it that way. You have to study, research, and everything, and learn. I've been practicing and learning and researching since I was a little kid. This has been my dream since I was about 10 years old. 27 years later, I finally have the knowledge and the abilities and the money and the background to come out and do it. I even have a college degree in outdoor education, outdoor recreation, leadership, and management. And between that degree and my military experience and everything else, and yes, a lot of YouTube, all of that together and my childhood and everything has led me to the point of being able to come out here and go off-grid, taught me everything that I need to know. So, let's see. knowledge is the number one thing that you need to take care of to be off grid. And then you need to find a location to where you can be off grid and be self-reliant. You need to have a water source that is either well water or spring water, or it could be a river, a lake, something like that, but it has to be your own personal water source. Something that if somebody builds a dam up the road, like if my neighbor builds a dam, then I lose the creek behind me, but there's nothing anybody can do to stop that creek. I mean, to stop the springs. The only way that spring could stop is if they strip mine the field across the street. They would have to strip mine and get rid of all that in order to destroy my spring. And good news is they strip mine that years ago and they currently have no intention of coming back. So I shouldn't be losing my spring anytime soon. My other spring comes from over there, comes from the backside of my property and flows from the other direction. So if I lost this spring, I have a backup spring. So your water source, if you're going to go off grid, you need property that has a good solid water source. You need property that has a good fuel source in the woods. You need property that has a good area where has a large enough area where you can grow food, enough food to support yourself and your family and your animals. And with extra, you always got to have enough area to grow extra, more than what you need, because you have to be able to build those connections within your community in order to trade, because you're going to need something. You might need some material. If you don't know how to sew, but your neighbor does know how to sew, they're not going to make your clothes for free. But you got that sack of potatoes and they're starving, you give them a sack of potatoes, they're going to fix your clothes for you. You know, so stuff like that. So let's see. You're going to need tools and equipment that I prefer to have hand tools mostly. Like I have gas powered tools and electric powered tools, but I also have everything that I would need, or almost everything that I would need, in hand tools. So even if I had no gas to run my gas power to my two cycle engine tools, or no electricity, I could still plow my field, I could still chop my wood, I could still take care of everything I needed to take care of with my hand tools. I do not need all the electronics and everything that I have to be off grid. Those are luxury items and they make things easier, but I have backups in case I run out of fuel and stuff. So it's okay to have boondocking fuels such as propane and gas, as long as you're not reliant on those only. So if you're going to go off grid, it's a really good idea to have backup fuels. So I do have a generator for backup. I do have propane stove, a propane heater, and some other propane operated devices as a backup in case the wood fails, in case we can't get a wood stove going, if we couldn't, if we need an emergency happens and we gotta do something fast, we could start up with the propane while the wood stove gets heated up. So it's just a backup fuel source. But it's not a primary, and it should never be considered a primary fuel source. So let's see here. We have, to me, being off-grid does not mean being antisocial. It does not mean being anti-government. It doesn't mean being anti-anything, really. It just means being able to support yourself without assistance from the world, or with minimal assistance from outside. So we can still go into town, we can still go to Walmart, we can still go to the store, buy groceries, we can still go buy clothes, we can still go, we can still use the internet, we can still use the cell phones and the telephones, We can still do all that kind of stuff. We can still go to parties. We can still go socialize with the world. But at the end of the day, we come home and we have that option to disconnect. But we do not have a connection. We have no electric connection to society. No city power, no city water, no sewage connection, no no city electric, no city water, no city gas, and no city sewage. None of those. We have no connection whatsoever to the city. The only city connection we have is phone and internet. And actually, right now, at this very moment, we don't even have that. Not on the property. But when we get all set up here, we'll have phone and internet will be the only connection we have to the outside world, besides going out in the town and hanging out. But that doesn't mean we can't. It just means having the ability to do without those connections. So that's my definition of being off-grid. And how I define being off-grid is it's not being antisocial, it's being self-reliant and being able to support and provide for yourself, your family, your pets, and your livestock, and being able to help out your neighbors and your friends if need be. So I think Addie has a couple of things she wants to say. So. Most of my viewers did ask for longer videos, so you're kinda getting creepy. What you asked for.
Ah, gosh, we need our dock fix today. Wow. Yeah, it's pointing off into space, but that's okay, because I'm short. So, I think for me, defining off-grid is kind of silly before you define grid, because it's like saying off something but not having the something defined. Grid is, I guess, how you want to define grid. I could be...
I'm going to put it on the stump here.
Grid. Oh my god. Well, actually, I have a Facebook page, but...
I'm going to put it on the stump because she's stumpy.
I'm not stumpy, I'm stubby. Stubby, not stumpy. This is stumpy. It all depends on what you want to define the grid as. I am not off the electrical grid until we leave the RV park, but then I'll be off the traditional electrical grid because we will be producing our own electric. And like you said, the stuff we have that produces our electric, it has a lifespan, and we will either have to prepare ourselves for the shock of, ooh, that stuff's dead 20 years from now, or whenever it does go out during those 20 years, or we will have to figure a way to get new ones. Hopefully society hasn't gone completely AWOL and it's still there so that we can get more solar power, because I kind of like being able to watch movies and stuff on my computer once in a while, because it's nice. It's a good relaxation break. But I want to be able to do that without being on the traditional electric grid, because I'm not a fan of how most power is produced. I'm not really a fan of coal because I don't think you can really do it cleanly, and you can't make more of it, so it's kind of like digging yourself into a hole that you can't get out of. I don't like nuclear because I'm pretty sure you can maybe make a plant carefully and maybe have it actually functional without being super uber dangerous for everyone around it, but I don't think you can do that and make a profit. And I'm pretty sure everybody that's doing it is making a profit or trying to, so you're not going to have the safety that you need. And then once you've got that stuff, you get to store the extra waste that comes out of it. Yay. Not a good thing. So I'd prefer to be off the electrical grid, the traditional electrical grid, where you have your house wired to the power of the lines and magically the electric shows up and you pay the bill. I would rather pay the bill of, we have purchased some devices to make our own, and we just monitor ourselves and make sure we're using that wisely. Similarly, there's the how are you heating your home grid. Some people use electrical grid and multi-purpose it to heat their home. Some people use natural gas, and I'm not really a fan of natural gas either, because again, it's really hard to make more of it, and you're poking holes into the ground and you know, they're doing that for a profit. They're not doing it as carefully as they probably could be. So, not a fan of that. I'm not a fan of maybe everybody going off the grid to heat their homes with wood, because they did that a couple hundred years ago, and it wasn't exactly the most thing for the environment, because there's a lot of smoke that comes off if you have everybody doing it indiscriminately and cutting trees without being careful. But that's a whole nother, overpopulation is the root of a lot of problems, things to deal with, and I can pretty much be sure that I'm one of the few people that is willing to go off the traditional heating grid, willingly. I mean, if suddenly EMP hit the entire planet and we had to start heating with alternative sources, a lot of people would be out chopping trees down. It would be a mess and it would be a disaster. But defining grid before you say off-grid is, I guess, the best way to define off-grid. So we're going to be off the traditional electrical grid, yay. We're going to be off the traditional sewer grid, yay, because you're flushing an awful lot of good water down that toilet every time you flush, even if you're just peeing. And that waste is getting treated with all sorts of weird chemicals. I don't even want to know. There's all that water that comes out of the treatment plant with whatever in it, whatever they think is safe, whatever they say is safe. But when they say something's safe, there's always the lovely thing to remember that they've decided, I think, a couple times in the recent past to just be like, oh, you know what? We can double the safe level of radiation in the environment because it's okay now. We've said it's okay. Now it's magically safe. Well, it wasn't safe last year, but you've decided now it's safe. I don't really trust them to impartially say what's safe without saying, well, it's safe because we want you to be feeling happy-go-lucky and paying taxes and stuff. So I like the idea of not having to use some other treatment facility to deal with my waste. There's a lot of birds and bees and whatever else and camels and whatever all over the world dealing with their poop without flushing it down a toilet. It has not made the planet explode yet. If you're careful, I'm pretty sure humans can do it a different way without making the planet explode or everybody getting some weird disease and dying. So off the sewer grid is nice. Having our own water source is pretty cool because that means today we're not paying a water bill. Tomorrow we're not paying a water bill. We're paying for whatever device it was we built, and when that's paid off, hey, that's cool. And, you know, being off-grid doesn't mean having to be prepper. It's synonymous. It's something that a lot of, I think, people think tandem when they're doing it because, hey, if you want to be off-grid, you're probably thinking ahead for an emergency too in case, so might as well build it in while we're doing this. So yeah, in the future, if there was an emergency where for some reason everybody's city water was off for whatever reason, we're still sitting pretty with water. So cool. Being off that, the city water grid is great. I kind of like some aspects of society, not very many of them, but there are a few. So being off of the communication with the rest of my species network and grid, I'm not really cool with. I like to be picky and choosy, but I don't want to be completely a recluse. So there's one grid that I'm not willing to completely step back from. I don't mind living out here in the woods. I grew up pretty much in the woods, and that's fine with me. I don't have to be rubbing shoulders with everybody every day. But I like a little bit of contact. There's some people in the world I care about. I like being able to, you know, stay in touch. So that's one grid I'm not going to be off of, the social grid. I am not a Facebook fiend, and I am not on there 24/7 posting, oh my gosh, I just sneezed and I blew my nose on a Kleenex and I threw it away, ha ha. I have better things to do. There's a lot of wood to chop. But off-grid, I think, is a term that is kind of thrown around a lot like vegetarian. There's vegetarians out there that eat fish. I know there are. I consider fish to be an animal. It is an animal. It's not a mammal, but it's an animal. It's not a vegetable. You're not a vegetarian if you eat fish, in my opinion, yet they call themselves vegetarian. Whatever. It's not killing me, and until we have to have a defined conversation about vegetarianism between me and that other person, which we could do even if we just were like, well, this is how I define vegetarian, and that's how you define vegetarian. It's not killing me. Smile and nod and go on with it. Not a big deal. Just don't get your panties in a bind if somebody defines off-grid a different way until you're like, well, this is how I define off-grid. I wouldn't say you're completely off-grid for this reason, but you're calling yourself off-grid and you have a pretty good start for my off-grid, and smile and nod and then just be polite. So I guess it all depends on what grid you're looking at to be off-grid. I am not off the dog grid. I have my pets right there, my non-human interaction. I have a husband. I'm not off my social interaction grid. And personally, I kind of like being able to get some stuff from the like production grid. Feminine products, I'm not sure what they did. I've done a little research into what they did in the past, but guys, you guys have it easy. Girls have a whole other thing they get to deal with. Big pharma grid. I try to stay off of that one as much as I can, but sometimes, hey, there could be an accident and I get smashed by a car. I would definitely like some painkillers that are going to take care of that pain. If you can mix me up some painkillers that are going to take care of that pain right on the spot and, you know, keep me sterile and stuff all the way to the hospital or whatever you need to do, that's cool. I don't think it needs to be as expensive as it probably is, and there's a whole other big story there, but there is sometimes a place for society working together to create things that can't just automatically be made on my property here. That's, I guess, where bartering comes in and where exchanging products comes in. But for the most part, being a little bit more able to fend for myself and produce what I need right here is great. I'm looking forward to having goats and having rabbits and having chickens and stuff. We may not be able to make all the food we want right here. One day I'd like to make goat ice cream. I want to see what that tastes like. I really like my ice cream. I'm not making it out of the goat. It's going to be out of the goat milk, you weirdo. That's like bacon ice cream. Yuck.
Oh, did you tell them what we're going to name our goat milk?
Oh, we've decided, if it's not copyrighted already, we want to be, I think it was the moolah's milk?
Moolah's milk.
Moolah's milk. If we end up having a dairy herd of goats, it'll be the moolah's milkers. But, you know, I like chocolate, and I can't grow it here. If you can responsibly farm it somewhere else and get it to me, that's cool. I will trade you some eggs, or whoever needed to trade the eggs to get it to me carefully, that's fine. For me, off-grid as a lifestyle is more about being a bit more caring and responsible towards the planet. And I guess that's probably not what off-grid really is, because that's not what other people define it as, but that's why I'm kind of stepping into the off-grid path and where I'm defining the grid. Speaking of grid, my grid of firewood is going low, and I think that's all I have to say without rambling, and this is a long enough video. So thanks for listening. And you're lucky I'm not writing an essay. I can go on.
Alrighty, so we will cut it there and talk to you later. Anyways, the battery's about to die, and it's a 37-minute video so far.
Just watch it in fast forward. That'll work.
Just ignore my shirt. Never mind what my shirt says.
It's just the shirt, not the person.
It's just the shirt, not the person, so... Anyways, quick look around the property, and so that makes three videos today, two videos for the off-grid property, and one video of a crazy driver on the highway, and we will post that along with her license plate number and everything, because if you know her, you can call her up and say, what the hell are you doing? But anyways, look for the other two videos. We have another long video, about 25 minutes long, talking about property security of our equipment over here. And the other videos of a crazy driver on the highway. So, all right, talk to you later.